How you doing?
Hey, buddy. How you doing?
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
How's your night going? How's this week? Merry Christmas, Jay.
Merry Christmas to you, too. This is our episode 2 days before Christmas Eve.
Yeah. Wow, huh?
It's going to be crazy. I mean, I don't do Christmas normally.
Really?
I'm a fantastic gift giver. Mm-hmm. I'm not so good at receiving.
When we were together, you were pretty good at receiving.
It's kind of different when you're with your soulmate. Like when you're with the love of your life, receiving, mm-hmm. it's like you get natural lubricant.
Yeah, for sure.
Do you have any like Christmas traditions or anything like that?
Well, no, because I never really celebrated Christmas, but you know,
all right,
as I get older, I enjoy the non-religious aspect of Christmas. But of course, everybody's canceling their plans because of Omicron, or is it Omicron?
Omni these nuts a cron.
Exactly. Yeah, so that's been fun.
Right.
I'm starting to wonder, Jay. California. I'm starting to wonder, Jay. I thought about this today. Maybe I already got COVID because I was sick a month ago and I just thought it was a head cold. And then I'm seeing the symptoms of what Omicron is supposed to be. And just so happens that that was all the symptoms were there. Wow. Yes, that digs on the super chat says 100 Habibis happy Christmas Xmas fatheads. Or is it
fatheads? Happy Christmas fatheads.
Or is it I believe that's pronounced fatheads or fatheeds.
Fatheeds. Happy Christmas fatheeds. That's what it is.
Right.
And it's funny, I asked you if you had any Christmas rituals or traditions, but I mean your wife is Jewish and you're mm-hmm. Muslim and your mother converted to Islam. But right. I mean, did they do anything at all like when you were growing up in the States?
Growing up I would go to my cousins or my grandparents' house and we celebrate with them, and it was a lot of fun, and it was a good time really, because I had no expectation to give them any gifts, nor did I have any expectation to receive gifts. Although I obviously desperately wanted to receive gifts. And I guess the most fun about it was just kind of seeing how they did Christmas. But I got a greater appreciation for Christmas when Emily and I started dating. And then when we got married, it then became obviously a lot more fun. So I dig it now. So, but you know, I don't know if I could hang out with my family this year because, Jay, somehow everybody needs to get a booster. And even if you get a booster, that's not enough. I mean, it's almost like the only thing. Yeah. It's like the only thing that'll get you, you know, somewhere in the realm of trying to keep COVID away is if you play this.
1, 2, 3, 4. Get your booster.
1, 2, 3.
Cause I can sleep for a little kid, just like the meat from a rocket ship. Sometimes all you need is a booster.
They all Habibis, take it up the ass.
Welcome to another Habibi Power Hour.
And again, to folks who are not vaccinated, you may think you're putting only yourself at risk, but it's your choice. Your choice is not just a choice about you. It affects other people.
You're playing right into their hands when you sort of like, oh, the vaccine. If you don't want to take it, you shouldn't be forced to take it. No mandates, but take credit.
We're looking at over 220 million Americans who just in the last several months died.
All right.
What's going on, Habibis? It's Siraj Hashmi.
Welcome to my locals community. Why am I doing this? Well, for starters, I wanted to give you more of my raw, unfiltered thoughts. I really want to focus on the stuff that really matters, and that's family. Sorry, I had to sneak that one in there.
Oh, hello, sir.
Assalamu alaikum.
Hello, sir. How are you? My name Hassan Bhatt.
I am photon in your face.
Oh, good seeing you, sir. How are you?
Hello, Habibis.
Oh, sir, it is. Oh, my God. Even when we are here, I still forget to change my background. What is going on here, sir? This is travesty, sir.
You must drink now.
Oh, sir.
You must drink.
Okay, sir. Oh, but sir, it is haram.
It is haram, but Christmas is coming.
Okay, sir, I do it. Welcome. It is Habibi Power Hour. I am again Hassan Bhatt.
I am Farzan, your face.
And we are here to talk about news and we have to report that both Siraj and Mujahed they go to be executed.
Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. So, sir, what are we talking about tonight?
Tonight, we have a very good show on our Habibi Power Hour for everybody.
It is our show now. It is Siraj Jay. They are going to die.
They are dead. They are not going to die. They are dead.
They are very dead. Okay, sir.
They had from their fathers. Dead.
Oh, dead. Most dead. They are
like the proudness from their father.
They are going to be hung by neck and have balls chopped off.
Subhanallah, mashallah.
Allah Akbar.
Allah Akbar. Takbir.
So, sir. Allah Akbar, sir. So, sir, how are you?
Hey, alhamdulillah. How are you?
I'm doing okay. But, sir, you know, this COVID stuff, this shit, this Fauci guy, this Francis Collins. You see this Francis Collins?
Yes. Francis Collins?
Francis Collins. So this Collins. This him.
Somewhere past the pandemic, when we're free,
have a shaitan.
This bastard guy, sir. This bastard guy. He in charge of pandemic. Activity.
Hada? This is in charge? Astaghfirullah al-Azim.
This bastard guy. Come
off. I don't know how we all haven't been dead yet.
He gives us gum.
For a nose swab every time we cough. As we are gathered here today, COVID's toll has hit and sent us reeling. But partners like the ones right here will help to make the pathway clear to find a true healing. Somewhere past the pandemic, life will resume.
Hello, hello, quota, illa billah.
We'll all complain about the traffic, forgetting how we hated Zoom.
هذا أمريكا؟ هذا أمريكا؟ هذا أمريكا. This is America. This.
Farzan.
We'll
this
hug our friends.
Is
and thank
essentially 100% haram.
100 essentially.
Pandemics end. My dozen years are almost through, but it's been
dozen
great
years
to work with you.
هذا الحيوان, he's
let's
like 70,000 years old.
Sir,
dozen years.
Oh, he has most beautiful voice. Mashallah, beta. Oh, Habibi, she say, come here. Hey, guys, remember when we won two world wars and defeated communism, sent a man to the moon, and invented internet?
This is all for nothing now, because this is what America is now. America is this shit.
It is most shit. It is Al Gore's George W. Bush internet, sir. Okay, sir. So we talk news. COVID, it is fucking shit up, okay?
It is fucking shit up, yes.
It is, you have Omicron coming in. They say, hello, sir, I give you COVID. And then they give you illness, but not as bad. Not as bad as Delta.
Or Allah Khan?
It is Ummi. Kus Ummi Khan.
Oh, Kus Ummi Khan.
Kus Ummi Khan. It is your mother's pussy Khan.
That's how I got it.
Mashallah, beta. So, sir, it is possible that this Omicron, they come here, they say, hello, sir, I'm going to infect you, and they give you COVID, and you don't go hospital. You just go home, and they tell them you have COVID, but now everyone has COVID. It is coming to the point, sir, where they are writing, you know, these journals, you know, these Brian Stelters, these Washington Post reporters, these New York Times reporters, they're saying, don't be ashamed, sir. Don't be ashamed of getting COVID. It is,
yeah,
okay.
Now they say this shit. Hella, they say this shit. Now, before it was a different saying. Different.
It was, if you get COVID, you are a stupid guy. You are haramzade. You are Batamis, you are Banchod, you are a Madachod, you are Haramzada, you are a bad person. Now, sir, it is like you don't even, oh, you did everything right. Oh, I mask up, I get three boosters, I have 69 boosters in my face and butthole, and I still get COVID. What am I doing wrong, sir?
You're a dirty whore.
That is true, sir.
That's what.
Oh, our Mayo King. Damon 12. It is 2L. 2L. Damon 12. Mark Bar America.
Mark Bar America.
It is. Sir, do you know what that means? What does this mean, sir?
Barqbar? I don't know, because it's not Arabic.
What is it? Is it Mayobic?
I have no idea.
All right, now we got to drink for 5 seconds. There we go.
What?
Delicious. I feel like we deserve at least like a minute or two reprieve from doing our characters.
At least. I mean, especially you took a couple of gulps of water there. That's
I know. I gotta stay hydrated. I gotta stay hydrated. Okay. We can do this. We can do this. That lasted what, a whole 15 minutes?
It did. Well, let's give it a 10. It lasted 10 minutes.
10 minutes. Yeah, 10 minutes. Keep going or just stay like this and just talk about the news. That was. I feel like we should finish our drinks and then do the rest of the show. Learn Persian.
Hey,
Damon, no, can I say Damon. Something? I want to say, Jay, I need to say something real quick. You know how in the 69th episode of Habibi Power Hour, I had the garb. You know, I had my shawar kameez. I tried putting this on. 6 months go by. I get stuck in this. That's why I'm not wearing it right now. I'm literally in the middle of that intro, that 2 minute intro. I can't get this on. It is literally stuck on me. Like, I can't get that arm through. What are you going to do?
Look, I bought this. I bought this on Amazon, like three size bigger or two size bigger than what I usually get.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a proper tailored one.
I gotta say,
it means death to America in Farsi. Why would I say it in Farsi when you English speakers can't understand it? I would just say it in English. Death to America.
Javi says, "Is Siraj trying to flex his gains?" No, I am trying to stipulate I got fat, but I appreciate that. I'll take it. So Jay, since the Habibis come to us, we really did try our best to go the whole episode not breaking character, and we kind of just were like, we have things that we're going to talk about, and if they go that way, then they go that way. But I feel like this is probably a better time to probably break character and just do what we do best, because that's what the Habibis love. And also because this is suffocating me. Just a little bit. And I'm sure you probably want to see Ernie. So we did good. We'll still drink up, but like, oh well. We did our best, Jay. Should I leave the kufi on because my hair is all messed up?
Your hair is not messed up. Stop it.
Well, Jay.
You look sexy as fuck right now.
Jay, stop it.
Can't help it. Stop it, man. You're like a 6.9 out of 10.
Nice.
Nice. And then you reverse it. Oh, got you.
Oh my god. So anyways. So this has been, everybody's losing their shit this week, Jay. Everyone in their ummuk.
No, it's absolutely fucking, it's like a recycled episode every 6 months. That's what they're doing over and over and over again. The same people.
Throw that back up, Spencer.
The same fear, the same fucking message, all of it. Even though we have moved forward. We have more information on it. We have better treatment for it. We have, you know, people vaccinated for it. All of this, I feel like it's now more than ever is proof that they just want to keep as many people in fear as they can.
Yeah, you know, and I was making this, I did the live stream last night. This actually ended up as the projected number one. And the full list will come out likely tomorrow. I have the list highlights content. Nice. This tweet right here, Ben sent it to us in the group chat thinking that this was parody. Then she turned off her replies. Where was the quote tweet set, Spencer? Can you scroll down real quick? I don't know if you could scroll down. He's a boomer.
Oh, yeah. He doesn't scroll.
15,000 quote tweets. Yesterday, it was 11,000 when I first saw it. Jeez. But if you scroll back up, let's read this. For those who haven't seen it, this is just some random Twitter
user saying, I'm flying today, but I'm not fucking around with Omicron. A checklist of Pfizer times three, negative rapid test, natural immunity, N95 sealed to my face with surgical tape, secondary mask for displaying opinions, because that's what she really needed, face shield, vinyl gloves, touchscreen gloves, shit ton of Xanax, and I feel like everybody can make that a assessment that it's not nearly enough Xanax. Whatever.
I don't think it is. And she completely just gives away the game on like how fucking crazy she is. Anyways, and I feel like this is what they want. These are the type of people, this is the type of person they want to create.
And well, the thing is, yeah, no, like we people are addicted to fear and they just want to continue to be living in a world where they're right about their fear being justified. I've had like, I'm like going through the motions of thinking about how everything is going down. And Jay, this whole story that we're seeing coming of this FOIA request on these emails between that Francis Collins, the now former director of the National Institute of Health, who resigned this past weekend. Like he was retiring. He's old as shit. And then Dr. Anthony Fauci, the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, who we all know has basically been like the pious saint of COVID. These people are colluding behind the scenes with respect to the messaging. Sort of like the media. Yeah, the messaging and the media takedown of even any debate or dissent with respect to our approach to COVID. So to give you an idea, this Wall Street Journal article titled How Fauci and Collins Shut Down COVID Debate. God, imagine if I had to do this whole thing in Desi accent. It would be most shit.
Very shit.
It would be most shit. So there's this fella. It is most gutum. It is. So, oh my God, Huck it out. He comes in here. He says, I'm late. Hello, sir. You missed best part of show. You missed best part.
Or was Different it? Time. Third time he's late.
Oh, how is he doing this, sir?
Every time.
Every time he does this to me, sir, Huck it out. Ben Morrissey, he say he is fired for texting this on chat and not in group chat. He says that woman is definition of who needs to be sent Gitmo. She doesn't want to have fun in life anyway.
I feel like a lot of these people have been using COVID as an excuse to display how they are really like in life. Mm-hmm. And as an excuse as to why they have no friends, nobody loves them, yeah. And they're single with like five or six cats.
Spencer, throw up that Wall Street Journal article real quick, because I just want to give you some context. Now, the American Institute for Economic Research, I'm reading from a piece from them, but this piece gives a lot of good context as well, even though it's an editorial. But let me start from the top, and I'll read the Wall Street Journal piece. And in public, Anthony Fauci and Francis Collins urge Americans to follow the science. In private, the two sainted public health officials scheme to quash dissenting views from the top scientists. That's the troubling but fair conclusion from emails obtained recently by the Freedom of Information Act by the American Institute for Economic Research. The tale unfolded over a year ago in October 2012. I'm sorry, 2020. Wow. So 2013 already, Jay.
What was so memorable about 2013 that you had to be like a year ago in 2012?
God, I don't know. That's a good question. 2013 was a shitty year for me. Anyways, the tale unfolded in October 2020 after the launch of the Great Barrington Declaration. Remember this Great Barrington Declaration. Highlight that shit, Spencer. A statement by Harvard's Martin Kulldorff, Oxford's Sunitra Gupta, and Stanford's Jay Bhattacharya. Is that how you say Bhattacharya?
I think that's how you say it, and it would be really good with a mango chutney and some like fucking lentils.
It is most good. It is against blanket pandemic lockdowns. Wow, I just broke into Desi accent for no reason. They favor a policy of what they call focus protection. And remember this, focus protection of high-risk populations such as the elderly or those with medical conditions. So that's kind of like the more, for a lot of you who are not as familiar with how we approached the COVID pandemic, the U.S. government did not do this. They did not go for focus protection. They did not lock down people within high-risk populations, such as the elderly and those with medical conditions. They locked down fucking everybody. Okay? So thousands of scientists signed the declaration, this Great Barrington Declaration, the GBD. If they were able to learn about it, we tried to give it some elevation on these pages. Now, I went through a lot of links, but what you essentially...
100%
need to know is that this Great Barrington Declaration was so much of a threat to the Faucis and Collins of the world living in their tall castle, telling Americans how they should live in the world of COVID. And obviously this went against the status quo, being everybody should be locked down. So let me continue reading. That didn't please the lockdown consensus enforced by public health officials and the press. Dr. Collins, the director of the NIH until Sunday, sent an email on October 8, 2020 to Dr. Fauci, the director of the NIAID, writing this in quotes. I actually have the full email. I'm going to read the full email for you. He says, hi, Tony and Cliff. Cliff being Cliff Lane, who's, I guess, another person over at NIH and NIAID, says, see gbdeclaration.org. So he includes a link to the Great Barrington Declaration. This proposal, and I'm reading this is in quotes. Actually, you know what? I can actually share the screen so you can actually can read along with me, since Spencer is a terrible producer and can't do shit.
100%.
That should be fired. Essentially 100%. Let me just zoom in a little bit more. Okay. I guess that's as much as you can actually see it. Shit. Well, if you could squint, then maybe that works better. Can we get better? More? Oh, there we go. We can actually see it a little bit better. All right.
Yeah. That's good.
It says, hi, Tony and Cliff. cgbdeclaration.org. This proposal from the three fringe epidemiologists, these free, Bhattacharya and Gupta, and then the third one who has a very white name, I can't remember, Kusumak. This proposal from the three fringe epidemiologists who met with the secretary seems to be getting a lot of attention. And even a co-signature from Nobel Prize winner Mike Levitt at Stanford. Okay? Get ready for this part. There needs to be a quick and devastating published takedown of its premises. I don't see anything like that online yet. Is it underway? Francis, this is the motherfucker running the National Institute of Health, who's pretty much in charge of the public health response to COVID.
It's insane.
We are literally dealing with politicians as public health officials, supposedly doctors, telling us how we should live, and they don't. You know, this is the before I let you go on your rant. Let me just finish mine real quick. This is part of that seediness within Washington, where they don't actually care about new information shaping or molding or reforming their worldview. They apparently know all the facts. They're too arrogant to actually acknowledge new information or even entertaining possible, say, contrary thoughts, because they are fucking politicians masquerading as public health officials.
Right. Because they have an agenda to push and they want to push it. And if this smoking gun came out as something against the narrative, we would have Brian Stelter on top of it like a fucking $2 Indonesian Thai whore. That's how quick they would be on top of it. Like a $2 Thai whore looking for foreigners. That's what would happen right then and there. And Brian Stelter, as you can see right here, would be one of the first people on it. And it is a scandal that there are no other media entities going after these emails at all. The only thing we have from this is the Wall Street Journal. And then now we're going to see Fox report on it and have a show about it. But that's going to be it. And it goes to what I've been saying about Fauci from fucking not day one. It's not been day one because I feel like absolute complete garbage. Like I was played trying to defend this piece of shit when he was under Trump.
Yeah.
But now I've come to the realization that he's a fucking lying snake. And like you said, just there to push the political line and narrative.
Yeah. It's very sad too, because there's actual valid criticism to be made about Fauci and Collins. And then you have dumb fucks like Jesse Waters getting up on stage at this Turning Point conference. And it's not like Jesse Waters has like any real like semblance within, you know, conservatism or the Republican Party, but he is a Fox News host. Just watch this shit.
Now you're going for the kill shot. The kill shot with an ambush, deadly, because he doesn't see it coming. This is when you say, Dr. Fauci, you funded risky research at a sloppy Chinese lab, the same lab that sprung this pandemic on the world. You know why people don't trust you, don't you? Boom! He is dead! He is dead! He's done. Now, how you do that? 30 seconds. That's all you need. 30 seconds. Now you get that footage to us, you get it to Fox, you get it to Human Events, you get it to Breitbart, you get it to Daily Caller, you get it to the Turning Point pipeline. Imagine Tucker Carlson teases out of the A block, coming up. Brave college student confronts Lord Fauci at dinner. Exclusive footage, right back. Get us that. That's what we want.
All right. So, given how much invective is probably directed at Dr. Anthony Fauci, I have to say, you cannot make a worse choice of words than what Jesse Waters did. Because instead of the focus being on, ambush interviews are something that Jesse Waters is known for, and he did them all the time before he became like a behind the desk type of anchor, commentary, opinionated host. And so instead of the focus being on, you know, get Anthony Fauci to say something stupid in front of a microphone or a camera or your phone, the focus now becomes, Jesse Waters now is encouraging people to assassinate Dr. Fauci. Just watch this response from Fauci.
Well, John, that's horrible. I mean, that just is such a reflection of the craziness that goes on in society. The only thing that I have ever done throughout these 2 years is to encourage people to practice good public health practices, to get vaccinated, to be careful in public settings,
you piece of shit,
to wear a mask. And for that, you have some guy out there saying that people giving me a kill
repeatedly
shot to ambush me. I mean, what kind of craziness is there in society these days? That's awful that he said that. And he's going to go very likely unaccountable. I mean, whatever network he's on is not going
to
do anything.
Fauci didn't even listen to what he said.
That's crazy. The guy should be fired on the spot.
Yeah, should be fired on the spot, right?
But
as soon as you give an inch, which is what Jesse Waters did, he gave them an inch. He gave them an opening. They fucking rammed, they rammed a truck through that shit, right, Jay? Right?
Oh, hell yeah. It was a train through a tunnel. Oh yeah.
So
no, it was. Well, I mean, I don't want to look. Jesse Waters and what he said, and especially like what are they called? TPUSA little bitches.
Yeah, turning
what
point. Turning TPUSA diaper wearing bitches.
Yes, that is exactly what they are. And especially because they still have like Charlie Kirk running it. And then they come on with like fucking Jesse Waters saying the shit that he said. There is legitimate reason to come on hard against Fauci. There really is, because he's a lying piece of shit. And not only is he a lying piece of shit, he may be completely responsible for a lot of the shit that has happened right now. He really, really could be. There's exactly a huge cover-up happening right here. And it's not – that's not a conspiracy, you know, fucking aluminum hat-wearing type of
claim
to make. It really isn't. He was there encouraging and funding gain of function. There is no doubt, no doubt. Anyone who says there's doubt is a piece of shit liar. There's no doubt that they funded gain of function within the Wuhan lab, and this is what happened. I mean,
okay. So Jay, real quick, so before you go on, speaking of come on, Jen Rubin, please come on Habibi Power Hour. It's our 100th episode. We'd be more than please. I want you to come on here. Please come on me and Jay and Habibi give us Jen. Just spill it, spill everything.
That means
I want you to cover
eyes and my heart. Come on, please come. Please come, Jen. I know you don't come a lot.
I just want you to come here.
This time. Here, and here. Come here, and here.
But mostly,
I said they were Democrats. All right.
Yes, which also isn't true. Actually, the only Democrat was Chris Wallace.
No, Ms. Raddatz and Mr. Cooper are Democrats. You did not know that?
You've made excuses for the locker up comment. You've pleaded with Ted Cruz, and he's really an honest man.
When did I make excuses for lock her up? What did I exactly say?
That would have been on, let's see if I have the date exactly. It would have been on, lock her up would have been on... in April and also in August. In October, if you remember, Charles Krauthammer came on and had a very vigorous argument.
Wait a minute. What did I say about in April and August? What exactly did I say?
Right. Well, we can
Charles
Krauthammer
came on.
No, I want that one.
May he rest in peace.
Which one in particular?
April or August?
Okay. Let's see. In August,
those lip smacks.
We had comments that you were going to. You would, if somebody is being really dishonest, referring to the press corps, you'd strip them of their credentials as well. Doesn't sound like an independent thing.
That doesn't have anything to do with lock them up. You are ill prepared for this interview, Ms. Rubin.
No, I'm not. I have a whole list here.
Ms. Rubin, I have just given you a minute where you've hemmed and hawed.
You said I justified
a comment, lock her up. You can't point to it, and then you pivot to something else.
This is the point I want to make.
Your column and blog are fraud.
Right. October 10th, you defend Trump's promise to put Hillary in jail.
Tell me how I did that, madam. You just can't throw out. What did I say?
You said that it was a perfectly defensible position. You can go to your own.
No,
clips.
I didn't. That's not true. I didn't say it was a perfectly defensible.
Read my comments.
Do you have my comments there? Read them.
I don't have them word for word,
you're
but I have the date.
And
you know what I'll do, Bill? I'll put them up at my website
and people can judge for themselves. You know how many people are going to come to your website? Zero. Because you're not an honest analysis person.
Ill-prepared. Just glass.
Ill-prepared.
Okay. So, Jay, I really, getting back to the issue at hand, this hand, of course, is that everything with respect to COVID is designed to destroy American society, whether you believe that's happening wittingly or unwittingly. What are you doing, Spencer? Are you letting us just go on rants? It just throws us off. Just keep us this way.
Fired him. You fucking fired. Anyways, where I was getting at was that I was thinking about this a lot over the week. I've said it on the stream. What happened, Jay?
No, I was just laughing at what happened right now. Sorry.
I was trying to zoom in for what Jay was doing. I'd like to make that very clear. I was only trying to zoom in on Jay, and it didn't work well.
What was it that you, what was he trying to zoom in on?
This.
Oh.
Oh, God. Anyways.
You remember that stroke.
I do. I do. Anyways, Jay, you know, I want to get your thoughts on this because there's a lot to be said about how COVID originated. And more evidence is coming out that the lab leak theory is actually the most likely possibility. The only difference is whether it's deliberate or not. And I'm starting to think that it's deliberate based on how unwilling the Chinese Communist Party is to work with any investigators trying to get to the bottom of the of this lab leak theory. And the obfuscation by people like Anthony Fauci and Francis Collins and their revelation that their emails were showing that they're operating like politicians. I almost think that everything you're seeing happen is deliberate, and it's deliberately done. Like the goal is here to destroy American society and American culture. That might sound like hyperbole to some people, but like that is the goal. Right, because if you think about it, the things that Americans really cherish are, we're very outgoing social people. Some of us are very nice. Others, of course, we have a track record of being big assholes. But in at least in modern times, over the last like 50 years, Americans have gotten nicer and nicer. And we become this giant melting pot where no matter where you're from, who you love, what God you pray to or lack thereof, what color your skin is, most people come together in these giant public squares. They could be concerts or music festivals. They could be sporting events. They could be church, mosque, synagogue, temple, you name it. And it destroys a lot of the division that people have, or these, you know, it lowers the guard for a lot of people that we usually put up. And, you know, I could go to a sporting event and I could become friends with someone who's completely different from me in every way, shape, or form. But we come together to celebrate, you know, rooting on this team, whether it be, you know, the beloved Arsenal Gunners, who are now a top four team above Manchester United. Just want to make sure I state that for the record. And everything that would divide us is to the side. We've built a common ground, the things that we can, you know, get to know about each other. And you start to learn, you start to like exchange, you know, information, personal stories, culture, you name it. And COVID didn't necessarily take that all away from us, but the government's response to it, particularly those on the left and those within, you know, the, I don't know if you want to call it the deep state, but the bureaucracy, the medical public health bureaucracy, they took that shit away from us. They tried to create a situation where everybody was isolated from each other. No one could go to each other. If you went over to a friend's house and you could get in trouble with the authorities because everybody had to be on lockdown. And this is one of the things that I can't get over now, is that not only is sports just so important and music are so important to American culture, you really start to understand how important they are when they're absent. It's very troubling to me to see how far people have let this go. And I hope, you know, I wish more people will wake up to this, because you're starting to see people trying to go into shutdowns now. You're seeing these professional sport leagues start to suspend games, even if they're postponing them. and it's all done in the name of public health. Soon enough, they're going to have to start to, you know, bar fans from ever going to these games again,
right?
Because we're heading for winter, or it's winter now.
It is, and the thing is like every other spike in you know, letdown, all this kind of stuff. We're in the season where people are going to be sick, and as you said, they want to be able to either divide us to keep us separated, or to completely destroy everything that we built. And it really feels like that's what they want to do. Because the people who are getting hurt the most are people who are independent, people who have their own businesses, small businesses, and you have little shit fucks like Elizabeth Warren to come out and be like, oh no, Amazon's getting richer. They're getting more money. Yes, because of you and because of the policies you want to put in place. You're the reason. These people are the reason why the richer are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. You come in and you say,
I never actually realized that until just now.
No, it really is, because you come in and you say this company, the workers either have to be vaccinated, have to do tests, have to do these things on their own money, all of this kind of stuff. And then they're the ones who are paying for it. They're the ones who are absolutely either paying for it, demonized for it. All of these things is happening to them. Amazon doesn't give a shit. They'll pay whatever they have to pay. They'll make sure it goes through. They'll do what they have to do to destroy their competition. Same with Walmart, same with Target. From the very beginning of what was going on, what was still open compared to independent restaurants and everything else? Costco's, Target's, Walmart's, Amazon. Why were these places still open? If I had a shawarma shop, I had to close down. Why?
For all the Habibis who sub to our Patreon, you can find us on patreon.com/Habibi Bros. Check out our interview with Carol Roth. She wrote the book. She wrote a very good book about this. I'm blanking on the name of it right now. The War on Small Business. How the government used the pandemic to crush the backbone of America. It's very well illustrated about how arbitrary these lockdowns were. And in many ways, it was almost very, fascistic. It was very fascistic because it was government colluding with these large global corporations and telling them, oh, we got your back. Don't worry. We'll scratch your back. You scratch ours. We'll let you guys stay open. And so long as you at least work under the scenes. It's not like anybody implemented any COVID lockdowns it's not like anybody shut them down at these sorting facilities. You had Amazon delivery going to every single house. And you want to know how much of a joke this all is, Jay?
Tell me.
When Biden implemented a federal government vaccine mandate, guess who got an exemption? The U.S. Postal Service, the one agency that literally goes to every single house and interacts with almost every single person known to man, because almost everybody sends mail. Almost everybody has something to send or to receive. Like, well, Jay, I mean, you don't always receive, only when you're with me. But that being said, when it has, you know, like the U.S. Postal Service Workers Union having an exemption from COVID vaccine mandates, is that, like, that right there shows you that this whole thing is rigged. This whole game is designed to control you and to make your life worse.
Right.
And it's just the government getting more power. It's a power grab. And now I'm out of focus. Thank you, Nate Beebe says.
Oh, no, you've been out of focus for like at least, 15 minutes. But I really think you're absolutely right. And going more into it, you see these like teachers unions, the most vulnerable of society, has really, really hurt. And when I say the most vulnerable, I mean people in school that are K through 12.
Mm-hmm.
And there's been a huge learning deficit within the United States. I mean, we've already had a huge one, and now there's even a bigger one. And I think parents and people are starting to wake up to what the teachers unions actually are.
Right.
They're not there to care about your kid.
Did you see that bullshit profile on Randy Weingarten, the head of the American Federation for Teachers?
On the New York Times. Michelle
Goldberg wrote that shit. Yeah, the New York Times. And they were saying, you know, basically, oh, she's all misunderstood and shit. And, you know, she's done the most to fight for schools being reopened. Just fuck out of here.
Absolutely garbage.
Siraj looks fuzzy. Jay's going to be hitting on his mom's. Glenn Greenwald tweets out, this Michelle Goldberg profile of teacher unions boss Randy Weingarten is fascinating because it shows the New York Times finally confronting the devastating enduring harm to kids from school closures and remote learning while exonerating those most responsible. Isn't that fucking wild, Jay?
No, it really is. And the teachers unions themselves, like, they have done irreparable damage to kids throughout these 2 years. And I honestly think, I know they need to be held accountable for it. And when I say held accountable, there needs to be a class action suit against these people, against Randy, against the teachers unions, against this administration that stood by these fucking teachers unions, especially with studies coming out saying there is a learning deficit that has happened with kids in kindergarten, up to, I think, the sixth grade, even K to 12. There's a huge learning deficit that has happened because,
yeah,
one, they didn't really do online learning as they should have.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Second, there wasn't really anyone there to be able to teach the kids to sit and learn and look and listen. And the fucking masking too. Like, if you're going to mask teachers, you're going to take away 60, like, I think it was something like 80% of what it is kids in preschool, kindergarten, all the way to the third grade use in order to learn to speak, to learn how to talk, to learn, you know, what it is that you're talking about. And that is facial expression, reading lips, all of that. It really makes a huge difference. And we want to pretend that it doesn't. Now we pretend like it doesn't even exist. And we had these studies from the 1920s, 60s or whatever compared to now. It's
Jordan Lethal says, mind boggling. Jordan Lethal says, I don't especially mind the teachers unions being all about teachers. What pisses me off is when they act like it's for the kids. And yes, that digs. It says we legit are getting dumber generation than Siraj's boomer gen. I love this, the irony of the dumber and how it was spelled D-U-M-M-E-R. Yeah, you know, Jay, this is all of this. Look, we live in a clown world, and it's one of those things that continues to radicalize you because while the corporate media during the Trump era was like, journalism is under threat. And I just realized this today. Twitter Blue, the new subscriber service that exists on Twitter, which I buy into, by the way, because it's actually, I mean, it's good for some things, not great for others. In particular, because Twitter Blue works with ad-free articles for a lot of these corporate media outlets. A lot of the money that now they're getting from Twitter Blue subscribers is going to these corporate media outlets. So like The Atlantic, New York Times, anything that has a paywall. So it's like,
see what your impact is for journalism. And I'm just thinking to myself, these fucks don't deserve it. They don't. They are lying to us. And they are, you know, they got caught in a lie once. And as soon as they got caught in that lie, then everybody started to question, oh, what else are they lying to us about? And then it became a result, you know, like an ongoing thing where people constantly analyzed. They did like an audit of every single thing that the media, the corporate media told us to say we were being lied to. If we were lied to about one thing, what else were we being lied to? So.
Oh, it's honestly the right questions to ask. And they use that as to try to make you as a crazy person, to try to make you as a conspiracy theorist when you're asking questions, when you're saying like, oh, these things don't add up.
So where I was going with this is the fact that, you know, you have journalists who are saying that their livelihoods are at risk, or like they're being targeted. And then you have, and this is actually a great segue into our next discussion, that is everything relating to Julian Assange. Now, he was extradited to the United States. And Matt Ophelia, who actually a partner on Rumble, he actually joined up when we did. He actually put together a really great montage about how Assange is being treated by the most powerful governments in the world for exposing corruption within those governments. Just watch this real quick.
Sometimes, to defend basic principles like free speech or a free press, you have to defend people you may find distasteful, maybe even people you loathe. And with that in mind, we need to talk about Julian Assange.
I think these espionage charges against the WikiLeaks guy are a huge deal and a very dark development.
They have him locked up in the highest security prison, 23 hours a day in solitary confinement.
This has been going on for a long time, and it shows how dumb we are that it took us a very long time, years, to ask the obvious question, what exactly did Julian Assange do wrong? Everyone, all good people, hate Julian Assange. What was his crime exactly?
It is not the same kind of criminal allegation they made against him in the initial indictment. It's not some hacking computer crime like they originally charged him with. These new charges are trying to prosecute Assange for publishing
things that other people sent to him. He was a journalist. He was an editor. That's literally true.
In newspapers and magazines and investigative journalists publish secret stuff all the time. That is the bread and butter of what we do.
Julian Assange brought you information that you had a right to know.
I would also point out the irony that the US government has spent the past decade pursuing Assange while failing to prosecute any of the alleged war crimes by US military personnel that Assange and WikiLeaks revealed.
Relating to two horrible wars, Iraq and Afghanistan, that we absolutely should not be a part of.
What this is now a novel legal effort to punch a huge hole in the First Amendment.
The first part of our Bill of Rights.
By labeling it criminal espionage to publish secret stuff.
This case is about criminalizing freedom of speech.
A new legal doctrine, a whole new legal lane for the US government that's never existed before, where anyone who publishes stuff the government doesn't want published gets prosecuted by the Justice Department under the most serious statutes imaginable, facing long prison terms for doing it.
He's being charged for what journalists do every day.
This is, to put it bluntly, wrong, unconstitutional, and downright tyrannical.
What he published was truthful information that the American public and the world had the right to see. He's a publisher, just like we are.
If Assange's publishing of classified information runs afoul of the law, so does the work of just about every single press outlet, this one included.
It would fundamentally change the balance of power between the people and our government.
All right, so that was Matt Ophelia. You can go ahead and subscribe to his Rumble channel if you're really digging his stuff. I actually thought it was a very good montage of Julian Assange and sort of the situation. Important context to note, though, is that everything that was said by like Rachel Maddow, Chris Hayes, Mehdi Hassan, like those were all discussed during the Trump years. They haven't said shit about it during the Biden years. Tucker Carlson, on the other hand, I don't know about other Fox News pundits, but mainly Tucker Carlson has probably been the most consistent on this, saying about it during the Trump and Biden years. So take everything with a grain of salt.
Fact that they've shut up about it. Like MSNBC.
The fact that they shut up about it now, obviously very troubling, because obviously the biggest development that has happened this year in the case of Assange is that he's been extradited to the United States.
and who's in the administration. And it just goes to show that Chris Hayes, Rachel Maddow, these people are completely full of fucking shit. They're complete pieces of shit and full of shit. If you can't be consistent during the last administration with what's happening now, you're complete garbage. And now he's going to go through some more shit than what he went through before.
Yeah. So Habibi, and this is true, is evergreen point. The fact that he was right about some things doesn't make Assange less of a dick. For sure. There's people get things wrong all the time. Journalists get things wrong all the time. Assange is being criminalized though for being a, like, again, where have you seen a journalist anywhere with respect to dealing with the United States government be treated in this way in this time the way Assange has? You didn't have this situation. Like, didn't like Hillary Clinton want the drone strike Julian Assange? I'm pretty sure.
It might have been her. I'm not sure, but it was people in on the left, especially after he released the Podesta emails.
Yeah, like I am sure that every single government official who is high up there wants to jail journalists. Like, that's just sort of like a ubiquitous thing, bipartisan, essentially 100% is the case. How are you doing, Jay? You doing okay?
I am doing wonderful. I am a third you down look like from you... Angel's Envy. I am a quarter, not a quarter, but like
I'm, I mean,
a
little Jay, bit down. It looks like you're having a great time.
I always have a good time, baby. Always.
But yeah, anyways, more about Assange. It's just, look, if you want to follow a good source on this, who's been covering this, Glenn Greenwald really has been the guy for that. And wow, I actually messaged him the day that they made the announcement about Assange. And it was funny because I asked him how he was doing. He's like, I'm great. Besides, I'm fucking furious right now with respect to the whole Assange thing. So, it's just, look, even if you don't like Assange, which many people do, look, I was one of those people when it came to Assange, I legitimately bought into the hype that he was definitely a Russian operative, or that he was at least a Russian cell or some way, shape, or form. He was a bad actor. And the way I look at it now is that if he gets prosecuted and convicted for publishing sensitive materials that emerge from some of the most powerful governments in the world, it sets a horribly bad precedent about the First Amendment and people being able to criticize or expose corruption within
the only government. The only way that it would be justified is if we can get complete proof that he leaked stuff to foreign governments. Just publishing things isn't leaking. If he like actually gave names, gave like burned agents and sources and all that kind of stuff directly to foreign governments, that's a different story. Mm-hmm. But unless they can prove that, it's like you're saying, they're coming after people who are just publishing stuff, who gain information and publish it. Like, I don't think that is, and especially here in this country, a way to force a treason charge that a lot of people want to force onto Assange. Unless the government can bring a complete and full picture of him colluding with foreign governments to destroy, or not destroy, but to harm the United States government or United States citizens or any of that kind of stuff, then that's a different story. But there needs to be a lot more leeway when it comes to just publishing information that comes to you. Because we need to be able to know these things and hold these people accountable.
All right, so Habibi probably is knows more than she's letting on, and that's probably, you know, look, I will admit I don't know everything. I am very much an idiot. But Habibi says, why did Assange meet up with Snowden in Hong Kong to get all the stolen data? First thing, he's not a fucking journalist. Saying, I don't buy into hype. My agency works with orgs like the NSA, and I know more about what he... Is that DJT? I know what she's saying. About what he did. look. And then Lord Peter says, my opinion, don't waste tears on Assange. Not a journalist, not a hero. Many people have been harmed because of him. Deserves his fate. If Assange really cared about corruption as an Australian, he should have been all over Australia. Look, and this is the thing. I can't... Damon tells us like I cannot reconcile all of his, like, I'm not defending his character, I'm not defending everything that he's done. I am just saying the treatment that he has been receiving is just a little over the top. So I don't know. We'll wait and see. I just feel like the for Assange, because he went after the biggest players in U.S. politics and the U.S. government, and I feel like he, it, oh my god, what? I don't have frosted tips though. This is just my hair. You know what? You know what? What's the Habibi Boy band named?
Jihadi Boys.
Yeah, I very Jihadi Boys. Jay, I think. I don't even know how to segue from this. Let's just go get Ernie.
I'll be right back. Do it. Go get him. I will read comments. No, go get him, and I'll read some comments.
Yeah, I'll get him.
Atomic Playgirl. Sorry, have to make supper, Habibis. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, Atomic. I hope you have a fucking wonderful weekend. I did say earlier that Siraj was the first jihadi recruit from NSYNC. That's very true. He did look like he could handle a bass. Justin Habiber. He looks like that bass singer from fucking NSYNC. I forget his name. Yes, I am, unfortunately. And Anthony Rivera was coming in saying, Jay, you still done in SoCal? I mean, I'm still in SoCal. I'm done with SoCal, but I'm still in it. That's for sure. Josh and Goldsmith saying that our band name is the Backdoor Boys. And Josh, you couldn't be more right, because I am, especially with Dan's mom. Son of Hell Horse. Siraj is the foreman for Habibi Boys 69. Frontman. Foreman? Did I say foreman? I said foreman, but I meant frontman for Habibi Boys 69. It really is. And yes, Bean Dude, Habibi Con, it's going to be, inshallah, June of 2022. And I think we're going to be doing it in Vegas. I am going to be talking to some of the other Habibis and to seeing what we can do, how we can do it, and make sure we get the information out to everybody on time as well, for sure.
Here he is.
Jay, can we talk about HabibiCon with Siraj Tanj, please? Yes, and he's right here. He just got back, and we can talk about HabibiCon.
Do you see?
Christmassy.
A Christmas bow tie for Ernie.
Habibi. So the next HabibiCon will be for the next 69th episode. 100 and so it's like 138. Anyways,
yeah,
we'll find it. I think it's 130.
So 38 episodes away.
Yes, and I think we're going to do it in Vegas. We're going to try and get it in Vegas. It's going to be in June, and we will send out promos, promo codes, and all that kind of stuff to everybody where we can make sure people can make it to it. Now that he has Earn, I need to go to pee. I'll be right back.
Oh, my God. Jimmy J. 009 says, Merry Christmas. May your carpets fly true. Thank you so much for the super chat, Habibi. Really appreciate it. Man, it has been quite a week. You know, Jay and I didn't have a whole lot of stories to talk about, but really wanted to talk about all the stuff with COVID and then Assange. Prism Mitch says, I'll be in D.C. the weekend of the 20th and 22nd for work if any Habibis are down for a drink. The 20th and 22nd of what? Or Pierce says, the Earn Awards at HabibiCon. We probably do need those. Okay, you want to get down? Let's read some more comments. I probably need to tip this a little bit. There you go. We probably should start a separate thread for HabibiCon. We'll probably do that on the Discord chat. And everyone says 138. Master Thief says Earn is now the second thickest boy of the thickest of the Habibi Bros. But who's the thickest? Me? I'm way too in focus. That is true. It's because I have good lighting. Jay, you good?
I am fantastic. I drank a little bit too much.
Did you?
Mixing Japanese whiskey and Angel's Envy.
Of course you did.
It's really good, though. It's not a bad mix.
Not a bad mix, huh? Damon says, we are 138 by the Misfits will be the theme song for Habibi Gone. Prismish says January. So January 6th, you're going to plot the coup d'etat in January. The weekend of the 20th to the 22nd. What is it, buddy?
Look at that wagtail. Oh, shit.
What?
No, that picture. That. Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
It finally happened.
We found him, son.
Alhamdulillah.
We found him.
Blake has been arrested. We stopped the steal.
Stop the steal 9/11 for January 6th and 9/11 combined.
Alhamdulillah.
Habibis, we got him.
I hope he resigns now. I hope he resigns now.
This will do it.
Inshallah. Also, inshallah. Habibis, if you didn't realize, we have a new intro. Mm-hmm. And the intro was made by... You can find him over on Spotify. Yeah. His name's $ on Spotify.
Oh, Jay, you know what I could do? I could go to the link you sent me for SoundCloud, and I can go ahead and play it for the Habibi.
No, no.
What?
The one I sent you on WeTransfer.
That one's it?
That one's it.
All right, let me go ahead and find it. Give me one moment.
You can play the whole song.
Inshallah. Oh, man. Last played. I played it on the repeat today. Here we go. Let me go ahead and share this with the audio. Oh, this is going to be so good. Habibis are going to cream their jeans when they hear this. Oh, man. Let's see here. Why can't I share iTunes? What's going on here? Let me try
why
something
is it
else.
iTunes? Wait, maybe I can share it. Hold
no,
on.
No, hold up. Let me do it.
Oh, okay. All right.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
You good?
Right. I'm good. All right.
Are you good?
I'll let you do it. Habibi? You can do it. You got it.
I can do it. We're doing you it. You can do Ernie's it. He's looking at me as he's humping his.
What's the urn? The urn. What is he on? Because I think I can share it because I have the I have it on my my
Here we
music.
Go. I got it. I got it.
You got it?
I think I got
Here
it.
Here we go.
No, hold on.
I think
I don't have it. Hold on 1 second. I forgot to share audio. The most important part.
This I right think. Here is boomer as fuck.
Let's hear it. Let's see if this goes through. Can you hear anything?
No.
God damn it. How are we gonna do this, Jay?
Okay, hold on. Let me see if I can do it. Hold up.
This is like the only way we don't get demonetized.
So we made a whole new soundtrack. And let's see.
So fucking hammered.
I'm a little hammered. But hold
You're
on.
Very hammered.
No, I'm a little hammered. Let's see if this works.
It's the biggest boomer. You're never going to live this down, Jay. I.e. me. Rachel Kaplan. Thank you, Rachel. Says, happy holidays, Habibi. I spent all my money on stuff for myself at the Black Friday sale, so this is all you get. Thank you, Rachel. Really appreciate it. Really appreciate it. Man, we're really screwed. Daniel. You guys are so fucking dumb. Jay, let me just find it on the SoundCloud that was sent. Just give me a sec here.
Wait, you can't hear it?
No, I can't hear anything, Jay.
All right, hold on. I'm sharing my if I share my screen, it doesn't play the sound?
It doesn't play the sound.
Holy shit, because I'm listening to it right now and it sounds fucking amazing. You guys are missing out.
I legit cannot hear anything.
Shit. Okay. How
here, let me try something. Okay. Let me try sharing a Chrome tab. And I could share tab audio. Oh, here we go, Jay. I got it. Get ready for it. Can you hear it? Can you hear it?
I can hear it. You can hear like kasomuk. You can hear.
Oh god, I could sing it to the.
Allah.
That's it right there.
You done did it now, Blake. You done did it now.
You done did it now.
So,
and the Craigler show.
Craigler show, by, Adam.
Come by to smash.
Habibi. Thank you, Habibi.
Thank you, Craig. Craigler.
Ernie, what is it, bud?
Boomer's trying to figure out stream in real time. Happy 100 at BBs. It wouldn't be the 100th episode without a fucking boomer moment. It wouldn't indeed.
I have to say, for one thing, Jay, is that people don't like this new song, and tough titties, really, because we constantly get demonetized when we play every other song.
When we play the other one.
This is the only song we could play that we don't get demonetized on. And
I think they're going to get it. I think they'll get it. Like, play the one that you mixed with the videos. I think they'll get it. They'll slowly get it.
You mean the intro?
Yeah.
They have to start from the very beginning, though.
Do it.
Just fucking do it. Okay, all right.
Again, to folks who are not vaccinated, you may think you're putting only yourself at risk, but it's your choice. Your choice is not just a choice about you. It affects other people.
You're playing right into their hands when you sort of like, oh, the vaccine. If you don't want to take it, you shouldn't be forced to take it. No mandates, but take credit.
We're looking at over 220 million Americans who just in the last several months died.
I'm not like that!
What's going on, Habibis? It's Siraj Hashmi. Welcome to my locals community. Why am I doing this?
I forgot.
Well,
about
for
this
starters,
part.
I wanted to give you more of my raw, unfiltered thoughts.
We dance way too good to the song. Way too good.
There we go.
I really want to focus on the stuff that really matters, and that's family. Sorry, I had to sneak that one in there.
Like the worst acting I've ever seen. You wanted it to be like natural. It's like,
I know, it's so good. It's intentionally bad. It's so good. It's bad.
That's exactly what it is.
Yeah. Faye Beebe says, happy 100th episode. We really appreciate the community you've built. I look forward to seeing you figure out your tech maybe by the end of the next 100 episodes. Thank you so much.
Inshallah.
Baby, really appreciate it. As you all know, you're all very much beloved members of the Habibi community. Jay and I cannot do this without your support. And yeah, not to get sent. People want me to play the vaccine song. I ain't doing it. You know? I'm not doing it. I'm done.
Don't do it. It's over. I mean, it's overplayed. It's garbage. There's no need to play it anymore.
No, Jay, it's good. Don't make me play the vaccine song.
No, it's not good. It's garbage.
Well, we're going to get demonetized if we do, so that's why I'm not playing.
It's a garbage song.
No, it's a great song, Jay.
No, it's not. It's garbage.
I'm going to just spam you for the next 24 hours with the vaccine song.
I mean, go ahead. It's still garbage.
Yeah, I'm going to. So.
Kala, Murugai Shayya, ippave unna kaiyoda kootu var sonnaru. Edho mukkiyamaana velaiyam.
Ippa varum mudiyadhu.
Ha? Murugai Shayya kooptum varamaatengriya?
Yo. Murugeshanukku naan edha velaikaarna illa koolikaarna? Varum mudiyadhu sonna illa? Poi sollu.
Unna tharatharam nilittittu poga. Aaloda vandirken.
Ye.
Shishya, indha chinna vishayathukku nee pogukuraadhu.
Why does this like sound so well for Jay? Like, it works so well.
I think Fuzzy made this. Who made this?
I think it was college.
Oh yeah, it was college.
Yeah, it was college, yeah.
It was, there he is.
So one thing I have to say though, Jay, is that video will definitely get us demonetized because it got us demonetized before. So at this point, fuck it.
Who gave a shit? Let's just do it.
Let's just do it.
I got the vaccine. You got the vaccine. They got the vaccine. We got the vaccine. We can get back to normal. Let me inform you. Let's all get the vaccine. It's about community immunity. I'm talking unity for you and me. If Doc says it's good, then trust me, it's good. Now let's all get the vaccine.
I'm the king of rock.
There is none higher. DMC, I will inspire. Time for us to trust and not debate. The vaccine, believe it's safe to take. 9 out of 10 people won't get sick. That's 90% effective and legit. This COVID thing is real and it will find you. It's killing our people. Let me remind you. Back in the days, there was polio, smallpox, back in the days. Measles and mumps, man, back in the days. But because of the vaccines, none of those days. Vaccines, they work to trigger immunity. 2 shots, we got antibody security. We gotta act now, no need to wait. Get your vaccine before it's too late, for real.
It's never stops being so good. But now comes to our favorite but last segment of the evening, and that is Ask Us Anything. So Ask Us Any... God damn it, Spencer. Every single time. Go ahead and ask us anything. I'm going to let Ernie go back upstairs. Jay will field your questions for now.
Take care. I will field your questions. Go for it. Stopping the steal, Blake, and making sure that you resign. That is what we're doing January 4th.
Jay, he found more things to hump, so he's still down here.
Hell yeah.
So yeah, go ahead and ask us your questions across Rumble, Twitch, YouTube. Go ahead and ask us them anything you want.
Lord
Peter on Twitch.
2020. Jay, are you gonna stop the still? Stop the still? No, I'm gonna let it happen. I'm going to allow the still to happen all up your mother's butt.
Inshallah. Son of Whole Horse says, how does it feel to legitimately hit 100 episodes? You boys really put in the effort every week. Well, let me give you... Jay... I'm not going to get sentimental on here. I can't do it. It's too much.
By the way, we have 69 viewers apparently across all the platforms on Twitch and YouTube.
Very nice.
It's higher on Rumble, but it doesn't account for that on the StreamYard. But that's down to 68. Fuck it. Anyways, Jay, I have to say this. Everything that we've done over the past year and a half has been insane. I did not expect us to sort of stumble into this and actually hit a milestone. 69 was fun, but this is crazy because I never actually hit 100 episodes in anything. You know, I couldn't get there with hashing it out because I left before I got the opportunity to. I did hit 69 though, so
nice.
That was fun. That was nice. But 100, that's a big deal. It's cool. It's you know, Damon then comes here and says Siraj giving a victory speech acting like he cured cancer. Oh my god. Janice says 100 episodes of Around that I will never get back. You know, look, I think it says more about you than it does about us that you look, you can watch anything, yet you continue to watch and listen to us. So
I mean, which is
really
amazing.
Who's really to blame for this, really?
And also it seems like you just like to torture yourself. But luckily, I am told you're going to be getting your Ernie postcards, Janice. I'm told. That's what I've been told. I don't know if it's going to happen or not, but I've been told you're getting them.
Yeah. Once I get back after the holidays, Christmas cards.
That's what was said like year. two years ago.
Oh my god. I actually have something really good in store, so
inshallah. So
it's gonna be good. I'm very excited about that. Yeah, but go ahead, you know, 100 episodes, definitely nothing to snooze at. But
no, it's not.
Josh in the Rumble says Siraj hasn't had 100 episodes with the wife. Oh my god.
And when he says 100 episodes, he means 100 seconds.
Not even 100 seconds.
35 seconds.
30 less than that.
15
I'm
seconds.
I'm talking 6 to 9 seconds.
Nice. But you lasted longer with me.
That's true. Oh. Russell Guy says, what's your goal for 2022, sirs? It's firing Spencer once and for all for stepping on my toes.
Absolutely. And also world domination.
That too. Sharia will always come for all.
Caliphate to
Master Thief. You. This is all Spencer's doing because this is Spencer simping right here. No Spencer puts in the effort. These gahbas just flood their lines every opening. That's also true.
Master Thief is also Spencer. I mean, this is one of the same.
Yeah, person. It has to be. It has to be true. Ernie, what you doing, bud? He's done humping something, so he came back to rely on me for something.
Oh, shit. You found my burner.
Ah, there it is. Found the burner.
We there found it.
His alt. His alt. Got to sack him. Should I go for...
No, go ahead.
What?
No, you said Rumble?
Oh, I was going to say we have 69 viewers on Rumble right now. That's pretty nice.
That it's very nice. Very and nice. I was wondering, should I go to Taco Bell or should I go to Chick-fil-A for dinner? Yeah.
Jay, what are you feeling?
Taco Bell, always.
Then go to Taco Bell.
That's where I'm going.
Jordan Lethal says, imagine simping for Spencer when you could be simping for Shu. Oh, by the way, I was on my road trip back up to DC. I got some Chick-fil-A. I got their peppermint milkshake. It is incredible.
Isn't it? It's good,
it's
right?
Really good. It's really good. Really good. Hawkeye says, love you all, Habibis. Love this A1 Tip Top first class community you both have created. Jay, I really don't know how he did that.
I don't either.
Yeah.
I don't either. It's absolutely insane. And honestly, the community grows because of you. Honestly, I mean, I know it sounds cliche and shit, but it's really because of you, Habibis, because we're, it's amazing. And everybody should get grab onto the Discord.
Yeah. Professor Puppet says Chick-fil-A and get a lemonade. Daniel Whitmer, aka Daniel Garmo, says, gotta say, coming from holding your hands, coming through how to get your audio working on stream. So 100 episodes is pretty amazing. You guys have come so far, and I still hate you both. Makes sense.
It really does. Sense.
So, you know, I think, Jay, that's enough for an evening. I hope everybody here has a very wonderful Merry Christmas and a happy holiday. Whatever it is that you observe or celebrate, we hope it is wonderful. Jay, I think we're still on for doing next week, are we not?
I think we are.
Yeah. So next week is our year in review, Habibi Power Hour. We will be live Wednesday night, 9 p.m. East, 6 p.m. Pacific. That'll be the final Wednesday of 2021, a garbage year, but there were some silver linings. So we'll go try to get through as much of the past year as we can. And Frostbite says, well, I'm glad I made it for the last 5 minutes. Don't worry, Habibi. We got it all on Rumble. We got it all on YouTube. You go back and watch that replay, Habibi. Anthony Rivera says, them just casually ignoring my comment is the highlight of my day. I don't even know which comment because that's how hard I ignored it.
Exactly right. Me too.
So, Habibis, love you all. For the VB Bros, shout out to Ben Morrissey and Spencer Sachs for doing a great job this year, even though they both should be fired. We hope they both have a Merry Christmas and also get a piece of shit in the mail from both Jay and I as a gift. We can't wait. Very excited to watch their reaction videos when they open it. So for the Habibi Bros, I'm Siraj Hashmi.
I'm Jay Kobbe.
And we only lasted 10 minutes in character before we said we couldn't do it anymore.
So I'm going to finish this.
Yeah, Habibis, hope y'all have a good night. Merry Christmas, and we'll see you next week on Habibi Power Hour. Good night. Masalama.